The passage from God's Word that we're going to look at this morning is found in Proverbs. So if you have your Bible, I'd encourage you to turn to Proverbs chapter 3. If you turn to the middle of your Bible, you'll probably come to Psalms. And if you flip over just a little bit further toward the back of your Bible, you'll come to the very next book is Proverbs. And we're going to be looking at two verses primarily this morning. For some of you, these may be familiar verses. Proverbs 3, starting at verse 5. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and don't lean on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He will make your paths straight. How many of you have claimed that verse, or those verses, as your favorite verses? Anybody in here? Okay, a few of you? Yeah. Those happen to be my mom's favorite verses. If you ask her, what are your favorite verses in the Bible? Those are the verses that she would say right there. I've entitled the message this morning, What You Should Do When You Don't Know What You Should Do. So, based on the passage that we just looked at in Proverbs, if I was to ask you, what should you do when you don't know what you should do, what would you say? Trust God. Very good. And I would agree with you. That's exactly what you need to do. Trust God. So, thanks for coming this morning. Bow your heads. Let's pray. That's about it, right? I mean, we've answered the question. Yeah. You're ready for a short sermon, right? I mean, no, give me more. But the reality is, you know, when you don't know what you should do, as believers in Jesus Christ, we would say, trust God. In fact, before we even went to those verses this morning, many of you probably could have said, oh, I know what you're supposed to do when you don't know what to do. You're supposed to trust God. In fact, many of us, if not most of us, have given that advice to somebody along the way who is in trouble and we're trying to comfort them, and we'll say, well, just trust God, brother. Just trust God, sister. You know, we throw those things out, and we know that we're supposed to trust God. The reality is that we don't always do it, do we? I mean, is there anybody bold enough in here that would say, I always trust God, no matter what? Okay, good. I'm so glad that we have all honest people in here this morning. The question isn't, what should we do when we come to those places where we don't know what to do? We know what we're supposed to do. The question is, how do I do it? The question is, how do I trust God? And I hope as we walk through these verses this morning, you'll come to understand that a little bit better, how I do it. The word trust in this passage in the Hebrew, it means a state of confidence or security. It means to rely on. To trust God is to be confident in Him, to be secure in Him, and to ultimately rely on Him. The reality is that everybody is trusting in something or someone. We all do. So it's not a question of if you are. The question is, who is it or what is it that you're trusting in? Because we all do. And we do it all the time, and sometimes we don't even think about it. For instance, most of us will go to the airport and we'll get on a plane with a bunch of other people, and we will trust a guy that we've never met, let alone know, the pilot, to take us thousands of feet up into the air and take us from point A to point B. And you go, yeah, wow, I never really thought about it that way. You're right. We do trust. But the trust that I'm talking about this morning is different than that kind of trust. It's a little bit deeper. And that's what I want to point out to us this morning. It's not that kind of trust that we put in a pilot. And so let's break this down together, and hopefully you'll kind of see where this is going. And my prayer is that we'll all be stronger in our desire to trust God when we don't know what we're supposed to do. Amen?
Amen?
So, let's step into it together. First part of that verse says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Would you put this down? how do I trust God? Trust God entirely. Entirely. Look, it doesn't say trust in the Lord with all your mouth. Trust in the Lord with all your words. Because it's real easy to say those things, isn't it? Just like we said a minute ago, we like to throw that out. Just trust in the Lord. I got to trust in the Lord. I can stand up here as a pastor and preach at you. Just trust in the Lord. That's easy for me to say because I'm not going through whatever it is you're going through in your life right now. Maybe you've even thought that since we started this morning. Well, this is real easy. But man, if you knew what I was going through, if you were experiencing what I'm experiencing, then you would know it's a whole lot harder than just saying the words that you're saying right now. But see, God doesn't say, trust in the Lord with all your mouth, trust in the Lord with all your words. He says, trust in the Lord with all your heart. And the heart, in the Jewish context here, and even in our context, it's the core of a person. It deals with their emotion, their intellect, and their will. It's that deep-seated part of the person. So when we say, man, love the Lord with all your heart, he's saying, man, love me entirely. Let's go back to our pilot illustration for a second. When I get on an airplane and I put my trust in a pilot, I don't put my whole heart into it. I don't trust that pilot with my whole heart. You might say I trust him with part of my heart because I'm trusting him with my intellect. See, the percentages tell me that plane wrecks are few and far between. The reliability of the airline that I've chosen tells me that they're pretty reliable. So my intellect tells me that I'm fairly safe to get on this plane and put my trust in this pilot. But there's no emotion involved. I'm not emotionally attached to the pilot normally because I don't even know him. So part of my heart is there, but not my whole heart, not the core of who I am. Unless, like I said, there's a relationship that's going on there. It's like a story that I heard about a little boy. He was on an airplane, and they were flying way up thousands of feet, and they hit turbulence. And the plane was shaking, and it was making those drops. And he was playing with a little car. Had the little table out, and he's just zooming around with his little car on the table. And there was a lady sitting next to him, and she was terrified of what was happening. And she kept looking over at this little boy playing with his car. And she just couldn't understand, how can this kid be so calm when we're about ready to die? And she finally couldn't stand it anymore, and she looked at him, she says, how can you be so having so much fun and playing with your car when there's so much turbulence? And little boy stopped and he put his hand on the lady's knee and he said, lady, it's okay. My daddy's the pilot. When you know that daddy's flying the plane, it changes everything, right? Because then you go from just trusting with part of your heart with trusting with your whole heart. See the difference? So when we're called on to trust God, it's not just an intellectual thing. Well, I know this and I've heard this, and so I guess, no. He's calling on us to trust entirely. You say, well, how do I do that? Would you put this down for number one? You do it with a heart trained through knowledge. Okay, because again, I do have to get that intellectual part. I have to get that knowledge part. I have to have facts and information to know that I can trust this God. And where do I get that? I mean, does God come, sit down, and give me lectures every night about who he is and what he's done? He could, but we'd all die if he did that, so he doesn't do it that way. He's given us his word, his manual for life, his instructions on who he is, what he's done, and what he wants us to do. And so we go here and we find this knowledge that trains our heart. See, without a trained heart, I'm not going to trust God the way that I need to trust him. Proverbs 22, if you want to write this down, Proverbs 22, might be in your notes actually, verses 17 through 19. Listen to what it says. Incline your ear and hear the words of the wise. Where do we get wisdom? We get it from the author of wisdom, God. and apply your mind, listen, to my knowledge. For it will be pleasant if you keep them within you, that they may be ready on your lips. Listen, so that your trust may be in the Lord. I have taught you today, even you. What is he saying? He's saying, get this so you know me. Get my wisdom, get my knowledge so that you know me. See, here's the problem. I think sometimes we fail to emphasize. You know, we talk about, we give out calendars at the beginning of the year with a reading plan. And we emphasize, hey, spend time in God's Word, journal, you know, get to know your Bible better. And I think sometimes we do a disservice. Because then what happens is we get into this book and we start reading it like we would any other book for the information. Sometimes what happens is kind of like our last study that we just finished, where we were studying different religions and comparing with Christianity. If we're not careful, we want to stuff our head with that knowledge so that we can win arguments, so that we can sound smart, so that we can sound spiritual. And the reality is, folks, when we come to God's Word, the first and the foremost thing that should be on our minds is, God, I want to know you better. Show me more of who you are as I read your Word today, God. Show me how you work in the lives then and how you're going to work in my life today. God, I want to know you in a deeper and a better and a more intimate way. And so that comes. I learn to trust God as my heart is trained through the knowledge of God's Word. Here's number two. I learn to trust God with my whole heart when I have a heart that's been trained through experiences. Through experiences. See, I can know God through His Word, but there's another level of knowledge that only comes through the experiences of my life. My heart can be trained to trust God through these experiences, because what happens then, I see firsthand what I have read here come forth in my life. See? Then it goes from being theory to being reality. See, we can talk about God doing special things and miraculous things and amazing things, and we can be excited about that to a point. We can even encourage each other with that to a point. But when you see it firsthand, when you see God step into your life and do some amazing things firsthand, that changes the whole dynamic of things. Amen? And so what happens is our heart, if we're going to trust God with our whole heart, we've got to be trained in the knowledge of who God is. But we've also got to be trained through the experiences of life that God allows to come our way. Listen to Psalm 106:7. This is talking about when Israel came out of Egypt. Our fathers in Egypt did not understand your wonders. They did not remember your abundant kindness, but rebelled by the sea at the Red Sea. Nevertheless, he saved them for the sake of his name, listen, that he might make his power known. What did God want to do? What was his primary desire to do for Israel when he opened up the Red Sea and they walked across? He wanted them to know him in an experiential way. They knew him from a head knowledge. They'd been taught about Yahweh. They'd been taught about God. But God said, no, look, not only do they not really know me, they're rebelling against what they don't even know. And so I'm going to part this sea so that they will learn to know who I am. See, God does things in our lives, folks, not just to bail us out of trouble, not just to save our skin. He primarily does it so that we learn more about who He is. It's through the experiences of life that our heart gets trained. How can I trust God with my whole heart? Well, I've got to have my heart trained in His knowledge, and I've got to have it trained in the experiences of life. Let me flesh it out a little bit more for you. Hebrews 13:8 says this. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, what? Today, and what? Forever. Okay? I read that and I find great comfort in it. Because what that tells me is that Jesus, God in the flesh, is consistent. And man, what an incredible comfort that brings me as I live in an inconsistent world. Amen? To know that the God that I serve, man, he's the same way, deals the same way, he is the same God all the time. So I train my heart in this knowledge. So, trust, like we said, is really easy when everything's going good. Would you agree? I mean, when everything's going our way, it's not difficult to trust. In fact, that's when we're probably telling other people, oh, just trust God more. See, it's those times when I pray for the sick and they get healed, right? Or I'm praying for a loved one and their salvation and they get saved. Man, it's easy to trust God then. When I drive into town and I'm praying for the parking space right in front of Friendly Market and it's there. Hey, easy to trust God at that time, isn't it? Man, God, you rock, man. This is great. People getting healed, people getting saved, parking spaces coming open. You are the God of miracles. Right? But it's hard when things aren't going so well. Right? It's hard when I pray for the sick and they die. Or I pray for the salvation of someone in my family and they seem to get harder and colder toward the gospel. Or I pray for that parking space in front of Friendly Market and just as I'm ready to pull in, somebody pulls in front of me and their bumper sticker says, "It's all about me." Pretty tough to trust God in those situations, huh? Pretty tough to say, God, I can't say it, God, because things are just going so bad. But if my heart has been trained in the knowledge of who He is, He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. Then when things are going good, I hold on to that. And when the experiences of life are a little bit different, I can still hold on to it because now I've seen in the good times that He is this. And now in the bad times, I'm holding on to He is this. He is the same yesterday, today, forever. That means no matter what circumstance I'm going through, whether it seems like everything's going my way and the parking space is there or it's not going my way and the guy cuts in front of me, hey, God's still the same. He hasn't changed. The training of my heart through knowledge and experience is going to bring me to that point. I come to believe that this God won't change with the circumstances that come. And that gives me great comfort. The problem is, if I haven't been trained in that knowledge, then when the experiences come, it won't make sense. And I find myself blaming God, coming to the wrong conclusions about this experience that I'm going through. Anybody ever been there? Anybody ever said, God, you don't care about me. You wouldn't let me go through this. You know what that demonstrates? That demonstrates we haven't spent enough time training our heart in the knowledge of who He is. Amen. It's like the guy that was he was dying. He was laying on his hospital bed and his wife was right there by his side. She had her hand on his arm and he looked up at her and he just said, "You know, babe, I want you to know you've always been there for me through all the trouble that I've gone through. I remember when I lost everything in a bad investment. And you were there. When I had that terrible car accident, you were right there with me. When I got fired, you were right by my side. When the house burned down, you were there. You've always been there for me. You know what I've realized, babe? I've realized my friends are right. You're bad luck." If you're not careful, and you haven't been trained in the knowledge of who God is, you'll come to the wrong conclusions about who God is. Yeah. Right? Yeah. You'll think that God's out to get you or that God blesses people who do a certain thing a certain way and go to church every week and get all the some crazy thing you'll come up with because you haven't had your heart trained in knowledge And so when the experiences come, it just doesn't make sense, and I might come to the wrong conclusions. So I can trust God with my whole heart, with my whole core, emotion, intellect, will, when I've had my heart trained through the knowledge of God's Word and through the experiences that God allows me to go through. So I need to trust God, and I need to trust Him as I go through life, through the experiences of life, knowing who He is, following His way, and that means with my whole heart I need to trust Him entirely. Here's number two. You need to trust God exclusively. Exclusively. Proverbs 3:5, and do not lean on your own understanding. Trust the Lord with all your heart and do not lean on your own understanding. Man, that is loaded, folks. I don't know about you, but you know, I hear verses and passages sometimes. I grew up in the church. I went to Sunday school, and I hear a lot of verses that I remember as a kid, and sometimes I don't focus on them. I just hear them, they're familiar, and I just kind of fly through them. And this is one of those that I've heard over and over. Like I said, it's my mom's favorite verse. She would quote it periodically. But when you park on that right there, do not lean on your own understanding. Man, that is loaded. It is loaded. Let me show you what it means. Here's number one. It means rejecting self-reliance. The word lean in the original text there, it means pertaining to being in a resting condition, often against an object of support. Kind of like this. I'm leaning on the wall, if you haven't figured out what I'm doing. The wall is supporting my weight, right? The picture there, lean not on your own understanding. Don't lean on your what? Understanding. The word in the original there means insight, discernment. Don't put your weight on, lean on, trust in your own discernment, your own wisdom, your own insight. But you know what, folks? That's what we naturally do, isn't it? That's what we naturally do. We rely on ourselves. We rely on our man, I just feel like, you know, it should be this way. Or I've been thinking about this a long time, never talking about praying about it, never talking about going to God's Word. I've been thinking about this for a long time, and this is what I came up with. The problem is, if I lean on my own understanding, I'm going to do some pretty crazy things sometimes. Like, you know, someone comes and slaps me across the face. Well, my understanding tells me that if I give them a crack, that'll take care of everything, right? What does Jesus say? Matthew 5:39. I say to you, don't resist an evil person, but whoever slaps you on the right cheek, turn the other to him also. See, my understanding tells me to do one thing. Most of the time, God's way of doing it is going to be totally different than what I thought I should do. So when I lean on, get my support from, put my weight on my own intellect, my own thoughts, my own wisdom, I'm going to make some pretty bad choices a lot of the time. Someone says, well, you know, I really feel like I'd be a lot happier if I divorced my spouse. I'm looking for someone younger and fresher and different, and I think God wants me to be happy. So I think and I feel that's what I should do. A parent says, you know, I don't want to stifle my child, and so I really don't want to discipline them. I want to just kind of encourage them to, you know, be themselves and do whatever. A church says, hey, you know what, we need more people. We need to get more people in here. Let's do some crazy stuff. I mean, you know, let's give away, you know, free drinks at the bar, you know, or or whatever. Just we just want to get people in here. We feel like if we could just grow in size, we would be more effective in the community. You see the problem? When I begin to just go on my feeling and my own wisdom, now I can do all kinds of crazy things and justify it. Well, I just felt that way. But do you understand that that's where we are in the world today? Everybody's going off what they feel. And even the church, many in the church are saying, well, God wants me to be happy, doesn't he? No. I mean, no. It tells us in 1 Peter 2, he wants us to be holy. And there is joy when you follow God. And you do, and we're going to see that in just a minute. But that's not the primary goal. It's not your happiness. You realize that? Now, I know that runs totally contrary to what the world's telling us. Hey, no, it's all about being happy. If you're not happy in your marriage, get out of it. If you're not happy with your kids, get out. I mean, they even tell kids, if you're not happy with your parents, divorce your parents. I don't know if you've been watching the headlines. There's some kid on the East Coast divorcing their parents. And not only divorcing them, but suing them for back services. You should have paid for this. You should have paid for this. And it's actually in the court system. Because it's all about happiness. And it's all about everybody being a victim. And I'm a victim when I'm not happy, and somehow you've encroached upon my happiness. In God's economy, folks, the goal is not your happiness. There will be joy. Please don't misunderstand. God's not calling us to be miserable. But the primary focus is not on your and my happiness. Listen to this, Proverbs 28:26. He who trusts in his own heart, listen, he who trusts in his own heart is a fool. How many of you have ever heard this? Well, just trust your heart. Just trust your heart. Go with your heart, man. Fool? You want to be a fool, then go trust your heart. I ain't trusting my heart. Because I know what's in my heart. You want to be a fool, go ahead and follow that advice. Because that's what Scripture says. He who trusts his own heart is a fool. Well, I trust my heart all the time. Well, then you're a fool all the time. That's all I can tell you. Because that's what Scripture says. So you shouldn't really talk like that. That's not really encouraging. I hope it's not encouraging. I hope it's discouraging you from following your heart. Because your heart's going to lead you astray. The Bible says that our heart is desperately wicked. Who can know it? And I'm going to follow that thing? I mean, come on. So what is this saying? What is it saying when it says, don't lean on your own understanding? Reject self-reliance. Here's number two. Reject reliance on others. You say, wait a minute. I thought that Scripture told us as a church family we're supposed to be supporting each other. In fact, Galatians 6:1 says that you that are spiritual should restore one who's fallen. Isn't that reliance? Isn't that trusting in others? Not in the same way that we're talking about here. Remember, this is a trusting with your whole core, intellect, emotion, will. We're never told to trust any man, any person, any institution like we're told to trust God in this sense. So please don't get that confused. But I am not supposed to trust that way in another person. Proverbs 29:25. The fear of man brings a snare. In other words, what does that mean when we talk about the fear of God, the fear of man? Well, the fear of God means to take God seriously. So the fear of man is if you take man too serious, if you take his opinions and his counsel too serious, you know what? Ends up in a trap. That's what a snare is. But he who trusts in the Lord will be exalted. Right? So you've got a contrast going on there. You've got this writer of the Proverbs saying, look, don't fall into the trap of following and relying on and leaning on someone else's wisdom and counsel. Man, if you go to someone for counsel and you go to someone for encouragement and prayer, and it lines up with how your heart's already been trained with the knowledge of God's Word, then you've got agreement. Then you can say, okay, yeah, I see that. I see what God is saying. I hear what you are saying, and I'm going to go with that. And ultimately, it's not you're going with that because they're saying it. You're going with it because God has already said it, and they're just agreeing with it. But when we come to a place where, oh man, this is bad. I got to call so-and-so and find out what I need to do. You know what I love, folks? I love helping people. I really do. But I love helping people learn how to lean on God. Some of you at different times have said to me, man, I like a couple of days ago, where were you? So, what do you mean, where was I? I was around. I called the office, I got voicemail, I called your cell phone, and I got voicemail, and I talked to Dana, and she didn't know where you are, and where were you? I said, I'm not really sure what particular day you're talking about. I was probably taking a nap or something, I don't know. And then they'll say, but it was okay. I was freaking out, and they'll tell me what was going on, but I stopped and I thought, wait a minute. I don't need Randy. I need God right now. And I prayed, and this happened. Or God really impressed upon me this, or I remembered this. And you know what I say at those points? I don't say, oh man, you don't need me, huh? Okay, well, thanks for sharing that with me. No, I always say, man, that's great. You know what? You don't need me. I'm just here to point you to Him. And when I'm not around, go to Him. And when I am around, go to Him. You don't need me. You need Him. Now, I'll do my best always to try to train your heart in the knowledge from here, so that when those experiences come, you'll be able to trust the Lord with all your heart and not lean on your own understanding or mine or anybody else's, but lean on His. Amen?
Amen.
And that's where we want to come. We don't want to rely on ourselves. We don't want to rely on others. We have to come to a point when we're trusting God that we're trusting Him exclusively. Here's number three. Verse 6 says this, in all your ways, acknowledge Him. Would you put this down? Trust God extensively. Trust God extensively. The word ways there in the original language, the Hebrew language that this was written, means a path, a road, a highway. Wait a minute. Acknowledge Him in all my paths, roads, and highways? Yeah, you and I are on a journey, aren't we? It's a journey called life. In fact, Jesus referred to that journey, and we talked about it a little over a year ago when we looked at misfits, the idea that we are not supposed to fit into this world. And in Matthew, he tells us that there are two ways. One is wide, and many are on it, and the other is narrow, and there are few on it, right? If you want to do things and have what everybody else has, go on the wide path. If you want to have what's right and good and pure and best, you're on the narrow path. But that's kind of similar to what he's talking about here. We're all on a way, we're on a path, we're on a roadway, we're on a highway. And we're supposed to trust God for all of the journey that we're on. It says this, acknowledge Him as you go on these paths. The word acknowledge means possess information about, to learn, to know. Say, wait a minute. In all my ways, possess information, learn, know Him? Yeah, you're getting it. Listen. The idea is this. As I go through life and I go through these experiences, the different things that I experience is opportunities for me to know Him better. For me to get more information firsthand about who this God really is. For me to gather the knowledge that I need firsthand into the God that I say I serve. See, that's acknowledging Him. In other words, so many times, I've been there, you've been there, where we've hit these situations where you say, God, where are you? Because, man, I don't know where you're at right now. It doesn't seem like you're around anywhere. And you know what? He's right there. And He wants us to learn about Him in that situation. And that's what it means to acknowledge him, to get to know him through every course of life. Because sometimes the course isn't always super straight. Sometimes there's curves. Sometimes there's hills. Sometimes it looks like we're going toward a cliff. And we're going, God, which way? Which way? God, which way? Which way? Where are you? Right here. I'm right here. And I want you to know me better in this process. I want you to gather more information about me. I want you to learn about me. And you're not going to learn it unless I allow you in this circumstance. Philippians 4, 6, and 7. This is great. Be anxious for nothing. What does it mean to be anxious? Stop having panic attacks. But in everything, look, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. What will happen if I really do that and I practice it? He tells us. And the peace of God, which surpasses all comprehension, will guard your heart and your minds in Christ Jesus. How can you sit there in this turbulence and play with that car? My daddy's the pilot. My daddy is in control. I've learned in turbulent situations that have come up in my life that I'm getting more knowledge about who he is, what he can do, what he's capable of in my life. It's not just theory anymore. It's not just a Sunday school lesson with pictures. It's not just some guy on a Sunday morning telling me. I'm experiencing and getting to know God firsthand, because as I'm going through this course of life, he's teaching me along the way. In all my ways and all my path, I'm going to know him better. Amen? Amen? And then lastly, trust God expectantly. Expectantly. Look what it says. And he will make your paths straight. It's one thing for God to say, trust me with your whole core, with your emotion, your intellect and will. Trust me. Just trust me. And then leave it there. I mean, that would be enough. But he tells us the benefit of trusting him like that. That we can expect this to happen. That he's going to make my path straight. And you say, oh, that sounds good. Like, no problems. Smooth sailing. That's what that means, right? No. No. The word straight there means this. Upright, right, righteous, just. God will make it right as you go around through life. Look, you've heard me say this before, and it's all through Scripture. God does not want good for you. He wants best for you. And we, the enemy is all about deceiving us to think that he's holding back good from us. That's what he did in the garden with Adam and Eve. He convinced them that God was holding out, that God had better, he even had best, that he was holding back, and if they would just do this, then they could get that best that God was holding out on. And he does it with us all the time, folks. Oh, look. Yeah, I know that God says that we should keep sex within the bounds of marriage, but come on, nobody's doing that. And look at all the fun you're missing out. And besides, you don't want to go into marriage inexperienced. And so we start thinking, yeah, you know, maybe God's holding on me here. Maybe it's not. And then we find ourselves drifting off into trusting, leaning, putting our support in ourselves, someone else, instead of God. And then what happens is we miss best. We miss what's right. Let me give you an example out of the Old Testament. Exodus chapter 15, verse 26. Israel was coming out of Egypt. They were in the wilderness. They hadn't gotten to the promised land yet. And God was giving them laws, and God was giving them commands that would separate them from every other person in that area. He wanted them to be distinctly different because they were supposed to reflect him to the rest of the nations around. And so if they lived like the rest of the nations, nobody would see a difference. Very similar to what God calls you and I to today, is to reflect him to a community that needs to see God. And that's what he wanted Israel, the nation, to do. And so he gave them some commands and he gave them some things that were totally different than the people around because he wanted them to stand out and be distinct. Listen to what it says in Exodus 15:26. And he said, this is God, if you will give earnest heed to the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight and give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have put on the Egyptians. For I, the Lord, am your healer. Now let me tell you what's going on there. God had just given them all these, what we call dietary laws. No ham sandwich, no bacon, no shellfish, no lobster. And you're looking at the list going, oh man, that's all the stuff I always eat. What's going on here? Well, if you look real close at that list, you'll discover that what was discovered a while back after this came out, was a lot of those things, if they're not prepared right, it causes you to get really sick, right? If you don't prepare pork right, if you don't prepare shellfish right, you can get really sick. And when you look at that list, which a medical doctor did and wrote a whole book called None of These Diseases, and he wrote on the idea that what God gave these people was to preserve them and to preserve their health at a time that all this information wasn't known scientifically. So God wanted them not only to stand out among the rest of the people around them, he wanted to preserve them. He wanted to give them the best life possible, free from disease. And God said, if you will follow these things, then you won't have any of the diseases that the Egyptians and the other peoples have on them. What was he doing? He was saying, look, trust me with your whole heart, and I'll make your path right. It won't be trouble-free. It won't have. There'll be some curves. There may even be some dips, but it'll be right. It'll be good. It will be best. You say, "Yeah, that's all great theory, Randy, but you don't understand what I'm going through right now." I'm not even going to begin to tell you that I do, because what you experience is tailor-made for you. And for me to look at your life and say, hey, I know exactly what you're going through, I don't. Even if I've gone through something similar, what you experience is different than what I experience. But I will tell you this. God is in it with you. And there's a purpose and a plan in it. And a big part of that plan is he wants you to learn how to trust him more. And the only way that's going to take place is as you gain the knowledge that trains your heart and you go through the experiences that train your heart, you will learn that this God is worthy of being trusted. So trust in the Lord with all your heart. Don't lean on your own understanding in all your ways. Man, get to know him, acknowledge him, and he will make that path right. So what should you do when you don't know what you should do? Trust him. Trust him. Trust him entirely. Trust him exclusively, extensively, expectantly. Trust him. Amen? Amen. Would you bow your heads, please, and close your eyes?